Hi and welcome. This is episode 40 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. I'm Daron Vaught. I appreciate you tuning in, whether via YouTube, Spotify, Google, Apple, Amazon, or however you listen. Bear with me for a second, because it would be pretty easy to botch this introduction for my guest, simply because there's a lot of ground to cover in terms of his accomplishments. Right-handed pitcher Kumar Rocker of Vanderbilt is a national champion, a College World Series MVP, an All-American in several contexts, the son of a prominent football coach, and a College Football Hall of Famer. He's a USA Baseball 18U national team alum. He was a World Cup gold medalist with that team for USA Baseball, and he's widely presumed to be the number one pick in this summer's MLB draft. You may also remember when he threw the first ever no-hitter in Super Regional history against Duke on the way to Vanderbilt winning it all in Omaha in 2019. He's also an incredibly personable and fun guy, so I was thrilled to be able to catch up with him. Here he is, the Vandy boy, Kumar Rocker, on episode 40 of Covering the Bases. All right, national champion and projected number one pick a little bit later this year, though that's the furthest thing from your mind I know right now. Kumar Rocker now joins us on Covering the Bases. Kumar, good to see you. Thankful for the opportunity to catch up. What is life like for you in the ramp up to this season coming up for you at Vanderbilt?
I say life in general is pretty simple at this point, just with COVID going on and stuff like that. But school, baseball, and then really just hanging out with who you can hang out with and going about that every day.
Now, I mentioned the projections at number one pick. You've got preseason All-American honors pouring in from just about every outlet there is. Is that something that you pay much mind to? I mean, obviously, there was a point in your life, in your baseball career, where something like that could have been, you know, whether it was a confidence boost that you needed when you were younger or something like that. How do you receive news like that? I mean, it seems impossible to me that you wouldn't see it, right? I mean, on Twitter and everywhere, places like that. What does Kumar Rocker do with that info?
I think a big thing you said is, like, it's something that you knew when you were little. And, like, I will say this for, like, I think me and most high school players around me is just, like, yeah, that stuff was really fun when we were young. But then as you get older, you start to realize, like, yeah, it becomes more of a business. Like, this is your life. This is your safety net. It's more so just kind of staying away from, like, that outlet of stuff, that social media. And, like, yeah, you can look on it, you can enjoy it as much as you want, but at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter what you do. All that matters is when you're on the field and stuff like that.
Now, we'll get into your USA Baseball experience here shortly, as you were a member of the 18U team. I do want to talk about your father, though, Tracy. He's a football coach, a member of the College Football Hall of Fame. Kumar, I didn't realize that until I was doing some reading up on it. How on earth did you end up being a baseball player and not, you know, Vandy's star tight end?
Right. The simplest way I can say that is after my sophomore year is I think I really started, like, it sounds weird, but get the hang of football, really just starting to enjoy it, starting to lift better, starting to get bigger, starting to just enjoy it. And it was as simple as just, like, you can't play in the MLB with broken fingers. And when he said that, when my advisor said that, it just kind of clicked. And I was like, yeah, like, I do really enjoy pitching. I'm not trying to have something that small of a nuance affect what I want to do in the big picture of things. But I'd say any other position in football, maybe more of an offense position, maybe like a quarterback type deal, blah, blah, blah. But like being a defense end, defensive lineman, I don't think that would work out well.
Yeah. Yeah. So you obviously played both sports at a high level up until that point. At what point did it become clearest? Hey, I want to prioritize baseball. I want to be a pitcher. Was it before then? I mean, obviously so. If you were being advised, hey, if this is what you want to do, you might want to steer clear of anything that can damage the fingers.
Right. Right when I called it was that junior year, is that spring scrimmage. That's the first time I was like, all right, I'm done with it. And it was hard for me, and it was definitely hard for, like, the football coaches for sure, just because I've gotten close to them. I enjoyed my football team. I enjoyed hanging out with that different group every once in a while. And I didn't get to do that anymore. So that was probably the biggest. That's when I cut it off for sure.
How'd your dad take the news?
Everyone asked me that. He didn't take it any which way. He was really happy with it. He said, I mean, no matter what with him, it's more so just like, if we're going to sit here and do something, do it to your best potential, stuff like that.
winning a national championship is the expectation at Vanderbilt, right? You guys obviously are going to be trying to do that again this season, especially with the missed postseason from a year ago. That was a weird time for everybody, right? I've spoken to a lot of guys who were either expecting to go play in the minors for the summer or were at the beginning of their college seasons. What was it like when you and your teammates at Vanderbilt found out that, you know, the season was going to be halted and we were going to be dealing with this pandemic for the foreseeable future?
Trying to look into a little bit of the future just inside of that season. I think the guys that we had on the field, the seniors we had, and just kind of like, I mean, guys like Austin Martin, guys like Harry Ray, Ty Duvall, guys who still had a very much of a presence in the clubhouse and were really looking forward to winning again. The energy was just a little bit different. And when that got cut off, it just kind of, it took away some of ours like opportunities and some other people's opportunities of really just getting drafted and stuff like that. And some people in my class as a sophomore, just kind of getting out on the field and having the opportunity to stand out. It took that away from a lot of people, but I don't know, we ran with it, and then a lot of people went home and they did as much as they could. And there's a lot of guys who came back from that quarantine in better shape, better mindset and things like that. I think it benefited us in the long run for sure.
That's interesting that you say that. Just because, you know, I've spoken to guys who, when you say they go home, it's somewhere where they have maybe not as many resources to, right, to continue to get better and things like that. Obviously you've got the time, you've got the drive to do it in most cases. What was that like for you? What was pandemic training like?
It was taking really what I've learned from here each and every day and applying it to things that I need to improve on, more so weaknesses rather than strengths. And just, you have the time to do it. You got a lot of time to do it. So you got to make the most of it. And when you look for resources around there, you can go to guys that have personal trainers, stuff like that, big facilities, or you can go to like local high school gyms, simple things like that. It's about finding a way to get better on your own and taking the time for yourself to do that with all the time that you do have.
Yeah. How would you say you got better during that time period?
I tried to be more athletic from a pitching side of things. And then in the weight room, it was more so, it was getting stronger in the little tedious muscles for sure. It was doing the little things, right? Simple as just some pull-ups, just increasing your lat strength and stuff like that. And last, I can't remember the last thing I wanted to mention. Command, strength. Oh, and then the diet side of things. It's being away from the field, being away from the road, and taking time to like get a home-cooked meal, as simple as that. And I think me and my mom do that really well, and it definitely helped me in the long run.
You find yourself cooking for yourself more?
Yeah, I definitely opened myself to a lot more foods too. At first, I was really picky, and I'm slowly starting to get into different things.
what's maybe something that you've discovered that's like a staple in the diet now?
It's really, you can add greens to whatever you want, really. It's keeping a fresh side of vegetables. And then this sounds weird, but I wasn't a big sushi guy. And now sushi, okay. I think sushi's a before outing type thing, before night out, yeah.
How about a quick pause for you and I to have another conference in which I tell you about what's going on over at usabaseballshop.com. Did you miss out on any of our most popular items that may have been out of stock after the holidays? Maybe it's whatever your favorite color variant is in the Nike Legend tee, or one of several masks from Baseballism, or a USA Baseball neck buff. Whatever it is that you couldn't quite nab for the holidays, it's all been restocked. So remember, you get free shipping on all purchases over $99 and get to usabaseballshop.com today. Now back to Kumar Rocker. The no-hitter, I want to get into that next, and I've sort of anticipated getting into the nitty-gritty of it. Look, man, it was in the Super Regional, the first ever no-hitter. Not only was it a no-no, you had 19 strikeouts. I think you had reached a career best at like 10 during that game and just built on and built on and built on. And maybe this is similar to the draft projections question, but what did that do for you?
It was – a lot of people expect the answer to say it was like – it made me more confident and stuff like that. But I'd say before that, before those like outings like Arkansas, Auburn, those are the outings that really gave me a feel for I can go out here and do this every day. And that no hitter got thrown into a part in that season where I was rolling and I was hot and I enjoyed it. And it was also a back against the wall type feeling. It was also playing for the team. It was helping those seniors out. It was getting to that next level. And they were looking at me to do that. So all I could do really is go out there and pitch and do my best. And the result was the result of it.
I knew you were gonna mention that. People fail to mention that Duke won the first game against you guys.
Yeah.
So it was such an important team win for you guys there. You hear pitchers and people around baseball talk about being in the zone. Did you have any idea that kind of performance was ahead of you earlier in the day?
Oh, I couldn't have said that. I know riding around with my roommate, he was just talking to other kids, like on his phone, his friends. I was just like, yeah, I'll give him 5-6 that game. I'll give him 5-6. Cause like, I want to get him in a position where they could win, where maybe I could hand it off to someone else and they could do a better job than me if I was struggling at that point. But I wanted to get him in a position that they could win. And I ended up going further than that.
Yeah. One of my favorite moments from it is the strikeout to end the seventh. And you get particularly emotional, right? And it's have another conference, right? I don't want to ask about the particulars of the moment, and Kumar, more than anything, I want to use that as a sort of a launch pad to talk to you about emotion while pitching.
Okay.
I see you as someone who uses emotion in positive ways on the mound.
Mm-hmm.
And you know better than anybody, there are other guys who pitch and you can never tell if they're pitching well or if they don't feel it just because they're even keel and things like that. How do you balance it and approach your overall temperament with the understanding that you can't get too high, you can't get too hot, but it can help you?
So I say like before the game, you're starting to listen to your music, you're keeping it all in you. And then I say once you get that first strikeout, that first out under your belt, you kind of like get to exhale a little bit. But then I also say to other people is I think emotion is earned. I think when you're on the mound, I don't think it's for like some people don't have the right to sit there and act like that or whatever. But I was hoping during that game that the baseball guys, they said to me like, yeah, like you are allowed to have a little fire in you, da da da, because you're in the position of winning, you're in the position of what you're doing right now. And I say emotion is earned to everybody. There's a certain way to act. And like you said, you can't get too high or too low. And I don't know, it's very much earned.
Was that as fired up as you've ever been on the field?
I think I've had other moments for sure. I think people just caught that one.
Well, what's an example? What comes to mind?
I say I get more mad when I'm just struggling just a little bit. When it's just maybe that wrong call, maybe that little dink hit. I'm gonna get more fired up about that one.
Yeah, the dink hit, the little
ooh, the flares
the
per
little
second.
Cheap flare. Yeah, I get it.
Mm-hmm.
We've had Austin Martin on this show, and he talked to me about the no-hitter and specifically about the final outs. And I think the way he phrased it to me was, you know, he had been on a roll, but at that point, at some point, he's at 17, 18 strikeouts. We can't expect him to fan everybody, right? So at some point, he's going to need to rely on us. I think I remember Austin saying he wanted the ball hit to him, Kumar. He was not as much nervous as he was excited to have the opportunity to help you finish that moment. What was going through your mind the closer you get to it? I mean, I think at that point you knew what was going on, right?
Mm-hmm. You asked me about like my adrenaline and stuff like that. Seventh through ninth, I say, is a blur. So when it came to that, it was where am I going to bounce this curveball? Where am I going to bounce this slider at? That was the end of the game. That's how it went for sure.
Do you have any idea what was going through your mind when you got the final out?
Oh, I was happy it was done for sure. I was just glad I was over with. I go back to the dorm, hang out with the guys. I was done with it. I was a lot of stuff going on right there.
What was the fallout like that evening? Were you getting blown up?
Oh, yeah. That was. I mean, it was crazy. I didn't know college baseball could create that kind of like stir, I guess. And then just coming into the locker room the next day was the funniest. Just walking through there, going in the shower, get your locker right, and all the guys just looking at you, shaking your head. I think that was the best part.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's cool because it's also this funny moment where
oh yeah,
you guys got to go out and do it again because mm-hmm. you know, that tied it at one game apiece. Oh, yeah. So that's cool. I'm glad it was received that way. And it's a testament to you and the performance and the energy that you gave. And just, you know, I know from your guys' perspective, you guys don't necessarily view your playing in these games as an entertainment product, but you know, when it's on TV, that it's a part of the equation. And as a college baseball viewer, that's about as entertaining a game as I've ever seen. So it's cool to know that it was received that way. Let's get into your 18U experience with us at USA Baseball, right? This was summer of 2017. You guys didn't lose a game, a stacked roster. What do you remember about being selected to represent Team USA?
I definitely found it as a huge honor, but it was more so, I think there's something to say about those guys who play 15U, because you kind of keep up with them a little bit and you understand that, yeah, they've been in that circuit a little bit. And having the opportunity to play with like those kids who have been on that team that you've just heard about, like Bryce Strang, Tristan Casas, stuff like that. I enjoyed being around them. I enjoyed seeing who they would pull from that 40-man roster and how they'd make this team just work together rather than keeping the egos aside. I was really excited to see that.
And I know you had been a part of some showcase circuiting prior to that point. When you first took the field with that particular 18U squad, were you aware of, and at the time, did it seem like, okay, this is the best collection of talent I've ever been with?
100% the best collection of talent I've ever been with. And I think it was the best in many years too. I think a lot of people, that whole class is very underrated, and those guys are moving up very quick in the minors right now. And I think I have something to say about it.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you mentioned Tristan and Jared Kelnick is somebody else on that roster.
Kelnick, Libertor, you got Gorman in there. You got Alec Thomas. Like those guys, they're dogs. Those are different players. Those are big league players instantly. Yeah.
Yeah. And without running through the entire roster, just to cut, you know, some others that I see, you mentioned Terang, Cole Wilcox. That's a loaded.
Those are big dogs. Roster. Yeah. Yeah. Those are big dudes.
For sure. What was it like the first time you suited up in the uniform with USA across your chest? Did something register to you there that was just kind of like, whoa?
Yeah. I think that registers, and I think taking a water bottle out the cooler and having some foreign word on it, I think that resonates with you a lot too, is to say you're in a different place, you're playing for something a lot bigger than yourself. But yeah, swagger's at an all-time high, especially for those POs in the bullpen chopping it up. Like those conversations are different for sure.
How quick, it's always interesting to me to talk to you guys who play on these teams, because it's different than any other team setting. You only get a couple of weeks of a ramp up to sort of microwave this team chemistry. And although it's usually successful because the talent is always there, it varies from year to year how the teams mesh and that sort of thing. How did you view it with that 2017 squad and in terms of team chemistry, how quickly you guys built it?
All right. We rode the bus 4 hours to Canada. We went through the border and everything. And I think I got to the point where we're pulling up to the hotel in Canada, and I look back, and like the heads you see are all the guys that you connected with, are all the guys that you hung out with prior to like even being selected to it. And it's like, wow, like I'm glad he didn't leave. Oh, I'm glad he didn't leave. And it's little things like that where I'm like, oh, we might be pretty damn good. So it was little things like that.
And what about the international travel component? Had you, you know, been out of the country much prior to that?
Right. I mean, the only time I've been out of the country is just like little family vacations. But that aspect of it, just, I don't know, Canada's full of wilderness. And I think that was really cool to see. And just the people around were really, I think is the right word, adamant to just like kind of see you and be around you and go to that ballpark, watch you play, watch you warm up. It was a very like pro atmosphere for sure.
Now, you know, I talk to guys who are from Minnesota or, you know, somewhere up in the Northeast, and going to Canada is not that big of a deal, right? Just like you talk to the guys from Texas and playing in Mexico's
right.
Not a big deal, not as big exactly. of a deal. Was there any kind of culture shock of any sort in Canada for you?
I guess I wouldn't say so for me, just because like I think the stigma around Canada is they're not much different than us. So I wasn't expecting to be blown away by some kind of culture shock. You know what I'm saying? Now Japan and stuff like that. Yeah, of course. Like I'm really open to it. I'm really to see what's going on over there.
Yeah, for sure. Now, another thing about the international competitions like this is not only where you go, but it's who you play.
Mm-hmm.
So that particular summer, you guys played just about everybody. I mean, looking at Netherlands, Japan, Mexico, South Africa, Cuba, Canada, Korea, Australia, and then Korea in the gold medal game. And again, you won all of them by a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But playing against a team like Japan, though, and playing against a team like Cuba, though, you get a taste of not just the culture from that country, generally speaking, but their baseball culture.
Oh, yeah.
What were your first impressions of how other countries approached the game?
Some of them were there to beat you, and then you got other countries there that are just happy to meet you. And I think, was it Japan, Korea, Cuba? Like, those guys show up to feel a little different energy than most of the countries. And I don't know, they had a different look on their face, and they were there to beat you. And it was little things like that. How their pitchers warmed up, I enjoyed that. How their hitters hit, the routines to get in the box, just the little things like that, and how they interacted after the game.
Yeah.
I think that was really cool.
Could you compare and contrast, say, a Japan and a Cuba stylistically?
I can't really get into the details with it, but I would say it's just more so just their play style, their mechanics on the field. It's just little things like that. It's what you see, and then like you just gotta see it for yourself in person. I wouldn't say they're completely different play styles at all.
I've heard you talk on other platforms about, for instance, your studying of a pitcher like Yu Darvish.
Yes,
it's sort of his blending of styles when it comes to the Americanized power pitcher type of style with what he learned, how he learned the game in Japan. Is there anything that you took away maybe from seeing another guy pitch in that tournament that was less commonplace here in the States?
Okay. From a pitch standpoint, no, but from how far your body can actually go. Yeah. Those guys throw around 200 pitches.
Yeah.
I think they take it to another level. And I think if you train your body to do that, you train your body to have endurance, it will do it for you, but you got to do it the right way. And then you talked about Yu Darvish, and I love that point because I recently watched a video on Carter Stewart, how he went to go play. He played in Japan. He's playing, I don't know necessarily the name, but he's got a little bit of Asian style going on there over there for him. And I think that's really cool because he was an American pitcher, and now he's got a little swagger to him now. He's got something different that a lot of people haven't seen.
Yeah, that's cool. And it's back to the Cuba point. One of our recent guests was Skip Schumacher, and he's the associate manager for the Padres now. Played in the professional national team for us at USA Baseball, World Series champion with Cardinals, of course. And he talked about playing, and I think this comes from his experience from coaching guys like, you know, he's got Fernando Tatis and others now, obviously, that are from the Dominican or wherever. And there's just he described it as a sort of hunger that when you go to these places, and especially in the case of Cuba, there's just more, they put more pressure on themselves because it's a chance truly to shine. And then there are other circumstances in the way of this, but then if they get through those other circumstances, there's a chance to really make a name for themselves and come to the United States and play in Major League Baseball. And the way Skip said it resonated with me because he was like, damn, dude, we showed up and it was clear that they wanted it more than us.
Oh, yeah.
And he said it was something he had never experienced before, but you just admit defeat in that category and just realize you got to be on your A game. Did you see any of that with say, you know, a Cuba in this case?
I closed the game against Cuba, and like, I'm like, the presence in the box, I'll give this, I say the presence in the box, most of them is aggressive and it's very intimidating. And that's the biggest thing that I took away from them. They all play fast. They all play hard. And it goes back to a little simple saying of like, hard work beats talent. And those guys, they grind it out. They don't care. That's their way out. That's the way of putting food on the table. And all you can do is respect that.
Yeah. Before I let you go, Kumar, looking forward, you know, national champion, you've got the preseason accolades rolling in. What is there that's circled on your, maybe it's a handwritten list, maybe you've got it typed into your phone, goals for this season. What are the priorities?
I want this team, we're a young team, and I want them to get hot and then know what it feels to stay hot. And once we figure that out, once we're rolling on all cylinders, I think it's going to be a lot of fun all around. And that's what I'm just hoping for them. Just because this year has been, it's been weird, it's been down, it's been boring. Like, simple as that. I just want them to have like crazy amounts of fun right now.
It's cool to hear you speaking as the vet on the team. Just from a fan's perspective, you know, we didn't get a full season when you were a sophomore. So I think most people probably still associate you as being a young guy, a freshman, and you know, having a lot of potential and a lot of talent. It's cool to know that as we've all been quarantined and just hanging out and waiting this thing out, as time has gone on, like you're a vet. You have a vet presence in that in that clubhouse now.
So
you want to win for the younger guys, and you want them to be able to feel and experience the things that you have experienced.
And I say a lot of people went home during quarantine, and like, you got to think, those like college students everywhere, they were growing up inside their house. That's where they had to do it. Their sophomore year is a big part in everyone's lives, and they were growing up in their house. And like, I think that goes with everybody. And I think a lot of people came back more mature, and I'm just hoping to kind of like give that information out to these kids.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, Kumar, appreciate the time. Certainly we appreciate you as an alum of USA Baseball and your contributions to the organization in that way. Best of luck with this season. Looking forward to seeing it. You and we got another guy right behind you there in the projected drafts in Jack Leiter, who's a former USAB guy, of course, and a lot of Vandy guys, as you know, typically come through our ranks. So best of luck to you guys this season and going forward in the draft. Hopefully we can catch up again soon. You know, we're hosting the draft combine. I don't know if that's on your radar, but maybe we'll see you in Cary for that in the near future too.
I got you. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
That'll do it for episode 40 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. Once again, I'm Daron Vaught. Thank you for listening, watching, however you do so. And if you would, head to whatever platform that is, whether it's Spotify, Google, Apple, Amazon for your podcasts, or now that we're on YouTube as well, and rate and review the show, if you would. It would be greatly appreciated. My thanks to Kumar Rocker for dropping by. Best of luck to he and the Vandy boys as they try and get another College World Series under their belt. Special thanks to Vanderbilt's Josh Foster, who helped in setting up the interview as well. Good to catch up with both of those guys for sure. Until next time, I'll catch you later.